Hey guys, this is Cerebellum. I'm here today with our 50th replay review. We're doing a review here today of 9muses Bristleback offlane. He's gonna be dual laning offlane. Most of the time I have already seen this replay once since I did do a failed recording of it. An update of OBS just kind of nicked my settings, I believe. The last recording I did not have any video at all, so yeah, that happens way too much. I need to get into a habit of actually doing just a test run, like a few second recording, just to see if everything's a-okay. But anyway, just moving on to this video. I did want to do something a little bit special here for the 50th episode, but I just got a new job, so I haven't had the time. So this is just gonna be regular little thing. I'm gonna go over Bristleback's abilities, his item build, what he's good at, what he's bad at. And hopefully it'll be good, since this is one of my best heroes, so I should be able to have a lot to say, especially since I've already said it once, which always helps. So this guy is primarily an offlaner. You can find him in the hard carry role, in the safe lane farmer role. The old Vichy Gaming used to do that a little bit. TI4, pre-TI4 Vichy Gaming. He's a really, really good tank owing to his Bristleback ability and to a pretty significant strength gain, though he can be a bit low on armor. So building into some armor in the mid-game onward can be a really good thing on Bristleback, but more on that later. With regard to abilities, he's got a really, really good ability here in Nasal Goo. All of his abilities are really big on stacks, so we can see it has a base effect. And then it has a stack limit and something you gain per stack. So in the case of Nasal Goo at level 1, you get a 20% slow first time you hit someone. They get their armor reduced 1 per stack, and they get an additional 3% slow per stack. So level 1 would be a 23% slow with 1 armor loss. Level 1, 1 stack, 23% slow, 1 armor loss for 5 seconds. And that's for 30 mana. So all his spells, or his two spells, are a really low mana cost, but you can do a lot with it once you stack him up. But you have to cast them a lot, basically, is the trade-off. Once you hit all the stacks, of course, it gets really, really powerful. And, you know, even at level 1, if you hit the 4 stacks, you get an additional 9% slow, which puts it up to... let's see, what's that? That's 32% slow, and of course it's minus 4 armor. But see, Bristleback himself only has 3 armor to start with, and that's actually pretty decent for a level 1 hero. So it's a lot, though usually you don't scale this up at level 1. It's a really good ability for doing Roshan, especially for dealing with heroes such as the Medusa here, who like to build into a Lincoln Sphere, since of course if you have a 30 mana ability on 1.5 second cooldown at a single target and does trigger Lincoln's ability, you can trigger off the Lincoln's ability really easily. And that's a 5,000 gold item you can just kind of try to put out of play there, so that's really good. The skill you probably should skill first is this Quill Spray, though I don't recommend you use it heavily at level 1, because this one really benefits from some levels. Now, this is kind of the damaged version of Viscous Nasal Goo, in that it does use stacks, and but it is an area of effect. And the other notable thing about it is that it's a physical damage area of effect nuke, second centered on the Bristleback, so it's just an area of effect around yourself. It has a base damage and a stack damage. So basically, once you fire it off, everything you hit in the radius will get the base damage, and then the stack damage, depending on how many stacks were already on them. It has a 3 second cooldown, the stack duration is 14, that was buffed relatively recently. So, not relatively recently, in the last major patch it was buffed, I believe, up to 14. So you really have a lot of time to build up these stacks. But the thing is, it takes a long time to build up these stacks at level 1. And also, if you want to use this kind of as a ranged attack, it is only 35 mana in lane to get a few last hits. You can't really do that at level 1. You can't really do that at level 1 because it's only 20 damage for the base damage, and having to stagger was both impractical, and you don't want to have to spend 70 mana on this guy at the lower levels to get the a last hit. That's a lot. So, you know, get it up to level 2 or 3 at least, I think. It has a damage ceiling, so even though the stack duration is 14, we don't have a max stacks on this guy. Then, you know, it can only do 400 physical damage. You can only get 400 physical damage every 3 seconds. for 35 mana out of this ability. By itself at least, because there's another way to trigger these, which I'll get to in just a moment. This is a fantastic ability for doing ancients and for jungling, since it is physical damage, it can hit mud golems, it can hit ancients, because they have magical immunity and this is physical damage. So it does jack all. But I'll get to that once I've gone through his abilities, since there's another ability, this one, Bristleback, which is also quite important for doing ancients. Not so much jungling. I guess if you have a really huge stack, you can do that trick, but I don't think it's really necessary there. So this is a hard damage reduction ability. It's basically, if you hit him from the sides, that is the 90 degrees to his sides here, or the back, this 90 degrees, he takes a damage reduction. It's really big on his back. At level 1, it's 16%. You just shave 16% of the raw damage pre-armor, pre-anything. And I believe it hits anything. From the sides, it's half that. So 8% level 1 from the sides. Yeah. And there's another effect of it, which is that if you take damage directly from your back, every 250 damage you take will trigger off a quill spray, and it triggers off a quill spray at the current level. So, and that also counts the damage pre-reduction, I believe it does. So this is this is a really good combination, and it makes for some really turny fights. Like you can just kind of turn around some fights if your enemy even slightly overcommits. It's very easy to overcommit on a Bristleback. So if your enemy is a diving tower against you, you know, they're going to be hitting you in the back, most likely. And if they're hitting you in the back, you both get damage reduction, you get the free quill sprays. The quill sprays stack up additionally, and suddenly they're doing, you know, 30 damage extra per stack. And, you know, that can just get really nasty, really fast. So, yeah. Yeah, so we're actually going to see that one a few times this game, that the enemies kind of overcommit on this Bristleback and get punished for it. Now, it's these free quill sprays that makes this guy really, really good at doing ancients. Because what you do is, once you have a few levels of quill spray and a few levels of Bristleback, and a few stacks of this ancient camp over here, which unfortunately it's not going to see this game, then you can just go over there, aggro them, just turn your back, spam your quill sprays, get the free quill sprays from the back, get, more importantly, the damage reduction from the back, which at level 4, of course, is 40%. And since you're already built into tank items on this guy, it can be really feasible to take like a 3 stack of ancients really easily. And yeah, that'll just grind them down really fast. So, in an old interview, Ice said that's what really would use the Bristleback for in the offline. But that was another meta game. It's just to stack up these ancients and get up a fast mech. Yeah. So I'll just finish up with the warpath, and we'll go on to his starting items, and I'll do the rest of the item build as we go along. Now, warpath is kind of a meta stack. You get a stack of warpath every time you cast one of your other spells as a side effect. So, basically every time, if you have warpath, every time you cast a quill spray or a viscous nasal goo, you get one stack of warpath as an addition to the other effect of the spell. So, at level 1 you get 20 attack per stack, you get 3% movement speed, and it lasts 14 seconds. So you get attack damage, and you get movement speed, which is obviously really good. So basically this means that once you hit level 6, you can just spam out your nasal goose and your cool space in pursuit of someone, and you will catch them because they're getting slowed, and you're getting faster all the same time. It has a stack limit that is tied to the level. It's 5 at level 1, goes up to 6 at level 2, and 7 at level 3. So, yeah, you can get 15% movement speed at level 1, and you can get, let's see, that is, my math is failing me right now, but it is 24% at level 2, and at level 3 it's 35%. So it's quite it's quite significant. And, you know, he does get really, really fast. But the good part, the really good part about this one, and you should skill this one as fast as you can, is if you can get some attack speed up on him in the mid-game onwards, and you can just keep yourself uninterrupted, he actually gets up to a really nasty right-click. We can see that, you know, your damage, you can go from 100 extra damage at level 1, which is quite good, to, I believe there's 150. No, it's a bit more. Let's see now. That's 400 and no, that's 150. 150 exactly at level 2, and at level 3 it is 90, 80, 210. Yeah, 210 extra damage with max stacks. That's 7 stacks. So you need to cast this ability 7 times. It can therefore, in the later stages of the game, be very viable once your mana gets up to the point where it can bear it, to just pre-cast a lot of quill sprays. Just before you enter the fight, just have like 6 or 7 quill sprays going. Is or well, maybe not 6, because it does have a 3-second cooldown. They only last 14 seconds. They do not like reset their cooldown. It's not like Lina's cooldown counter or cooldown Lina's stack of buff. It kind of works like that one, honestly, but that one resets every time you cast a spell, so you can reset the cooldown. This one, it just counts the cooldowns individually. So yeah, they will run out. There's nothing you can do. Yeah. I think that's about it I have to say about the skills for now. We'll see how he uses them further on in the game. As for starting items, this is pretty good. I really like the 8 tangos when going off the offlane these days. You also have a stout shield and an iron branch. The iron branch, a little bit random here. I don't think he really needs the stats. I would maybe have liked to see it. Looks like he went off to a little bit of a late start. But else he would have been able to afford a salve as well. Now, in a dual lane, that's probably a little overkill. But in that case, I would have loved to see like one tango, one salve, and then you can actually get something else. Because this is slightly less money than he should have had. I am really, yeah, it's slightly less money than he should have had. So this is pretty good. I wouldn't really recommend going for anything else. He doesn't usually build into tranquil boots or anything else you can make an early start on. And he does have a lot of armor early on, and this, honestly, this stout shield stacks with Bristleback, so it's just so good on him. In fact, one of the first items we're gonna see at 9muses here. In fact, one of the first items we're gonna see 9muses here go for is the upgrade to stout shield, the Vanguard, which is really good on Bristleback, especially if you can finish early. That's one of the things we want to talk about here. Because there's two things 9muses here does in the earlier stages of the game, which are, or actually there's three things, which I do not like. One is his skill build, I disagree with a little bit. The second is his item choice, I think could be massaged a bit. And the third is that he uses his quill sprays a lot here at level 1. Mainly because his skill build means he's not getting a quill spray. See here? Now, that activation we saw him use up there, that activation, 35 mana for essentially 20 damage to everything. Now, it's actually detrimental to use it on the creeps. He's not going to grab a last hit with 20 damage. The creeps have in excess of 500 life, the melee creeps, at this point. So, the chances of grabbing a last hit with 20 damage is super small. And then he's paying 35 mana to take 20 off the life of these two. So, that's 40 damage. For 35 mana, which is not fantastic, especially not when your mana pool is 200. So I would recommend use this ability once you have a few levels in it. It's fantastic to get blasted with once it's 60 damage or 80 damage. And also, once you get up in level as Bristleback, if I can just pause real quick, we see that he has a... Oh, I hate this interface so much. There we go. 2.8 int gain. He actually has a really good int gain. I don't know how much sense that makes with the character, but he does. Okay, so I'm locked to his perspective again. I thought I moved the camera just before, which really confused me, but yeah, we'll see. So they are in a dual melee lane against a dual ranged lane, which in theory means they should have a really hard time. The fact that they aren't really maybe speaks to the skill level of the opposition. The ogre kind of going on without the Bristleback here. Bristleback using a lot of quill sprays right now. It really doesn't, you know, it isn't. I don't think it's doing anything at all, and he's just reduced his mana pool to half because of it. So I'm not a fan of that, obviously. Though, if we look at the last hits, I believe he is doing quite well. He is definitely doing better than his Medusa, which I think is a little bit puzzling that he should be, since, you know, if he's last hitting, he can't really use his Bristleback to evade damage. Yeah, he hasn't even used that much regeneration, so he's doing far better than he has any right to here in lane. This is actually a completely correct skill build, so I misremembered slightly. He is putting a second level into Quillspray, but I believe he's gonna be maxing out Bristleback for now afterwards. This is when you do stuff like this on skills that don't really, like, it's not like Quillspray is kind of peaking at level 2. There's some skills, like some of Ember Spirit skills, get better in chunks. Or a good example is actually Viscous Nest, because we see that at level 3 you get an additional armor loss. So that is obviously the best level to get. You get a lot more out of going from level 2 to level 3 than from level 1 to level 2 or from level 3 to level 4, because that's just an additional 3% slow per stack. Yeah, though you tend to max that out late anyway, else I would, you know, else it might be a good point to stick that on 3, though the only alternative is really to put more in stats, which it is better than putting some in stats, so yeah, that's that. Go interrupting a stack here, managing to grab her last hit. Now we can see with level 2 in it, it's 40 damage. That's manageable to actually do something with it. But he is grinding down his mana very hard. And the thing is, when you grind down your mana this hard early game with Bristleback, if they fight right now, he is one Quillspray and then a right click. That is all his contribution to the fight. And that is not a lot compared to, say, Ogre Magi, if he had mana. Oh, the one Ogre Magic game I cast as well, he also just ground down his mana. But if he had a Fire Blast, he would have a 1.5 second stun and 145 damage. The Bristleback, if we assume they'll not fight with stacks on him, will only have 40 damage in AoE, so he can do 80 damage. Ooh. So, you know. This early in the game, I would say, try to keep your mana pool high, try to keep it available in case you need to fight and just spam out those Quill Sprays.
First blood.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Yeah. The Tusk gets first blooded. And Bristleback goes for a Ring of Basilus as his first item. Now, Basilus in itself is not a bad item. And I don't think it's completely unacceptable that when he's going Vanguard, he's going for Basilus first. Since it does help quite a lot with this regen, especially actually. The mana regen, attack. Especially. Just getting a little bit of mana regen can be very, very, very good. On Bristleback, since, you know, he is mana dependent. And without levels, he kind of struggles a bit with his mana pool. But with levels, we see with the nearly 3 mana or 2.8 per level, he gets a lot of mana just by going up in a level. He's already gotten 100 just by going from level 1 to level 4, we can see, so it's quite good. So in that sense, Basilus is a bit of a short-sighted solution. He doesn't really need the armor, he doesn't really like to push, so maybe it's not a great purchase. But the one I really mind, the purchase I really don't like, even though he is doing fine in lane, he's outlast hitting the Medusa by a country mile. This is an offlane that's being won. So the one I really don't like, the purchase I really don't like, is the Power Threats after this. He is going to go up for Power Threats after this this Ring of Aquila. And the problem here is that Power Threats is actually 900 additional gold. 950 additional gold. Yeah, 950 additional gold on top of his boots of speed. And that's, you know, the Vanguard is already pretty expensive for a first item. If you delay it by another 900 gold, it's gonna take a long time out of its chunk of time where it's really relevant. Or it does where it's really good. Because the Vanguard is beastly if you can finish it early, and then turns very mediocre, and then turns downright bad if you can. If you just wait with it, so you never get a Vanguard past 30 minutes. That would be really, really dumb. Like, almost, maybe at like the very bottom tier of play, that could be viable if no one has any farm. But here, it's just not good, because damage block is very reliant on your enemies having no right-click server. The thing is, Power Threats don't really give Bristleback very much at all. You get 8 stats, that's gonna sit on strength most of the time. So you get 8 strength and you get some attack speed. Now attack speed is much better once you actually get up a few levels of Warpath.
And honestly, the Vanguard's just so good you can finish it early. I think it's a huge mistake finishing power threats early on this guy. Because you're essentially just kind of locking down 900 of your farm to be not super relevant for now. Okay, the 8 stats is good. I won't say that, but yeah. Oh yeah, he goes for the Ring of Health, which is perfect. Like, that's absolutely what you start with. This is going to give him a lot of sustain in lane. And it's gonna be really, really good. But then he goes for his power threats. Kinda go. A bit of a fight going on. Not much happens. Yeah. So a bit of a failed gank here from the Klinks, but we somehow also have three of our guys down here. The Tusk coming down to do I don't even know. And yeah, it's So yeah, that was a bit of a long fight, but it does leave our Bristleback on a little bit of low mana again. Like, you do want to be able to throw out probably, like, here you want to have like 200 mana for an engagement. That's a pretty good number. That'll leave you with 7 or so quill space stacks, which is a lot, and that's about the level you want to be on. You want to be on slightly more, probably ideally you want to be at full mana, but you know, if you want to use a few for last hits, do that, but only if you feel like you really can't dive in for them. Again, the skill build I feel like is pretty wrong. At level 5, I would go for 1 level in Nazgûl picked up at level 4, 3 levels of Quill Spray at level 1, 3, and 5, and 1 level of Bristleback at level 2. So that's Quill Spray, Bristleback, Quill Spray, Nazgûl, Quill Spray. Instead, he's gone Quill Spray, Bristleback, Quill Spray. Bristleback, Warpath, Bristleback. So, he's got a lot of damage reduction. But, you know, if they're in a team fight and the enemies just don't hit him, well, he's only just really a right click. He can be a pretty good right click once he gets some Quill Spray stacks out, but that requires him still to have mana for it. And really, you know, you would get a lot of the damage reduction just from the level 1. Like, the level 1 is pretty close to half the damage reduction. So is it worth putting in 3 additional levels here and not getting you slow and getting a pretty mediocre Quill Spray? I don't know. This is quite reliant on your enemies actually committing on you, I feel like. Though he is going to outplay, he is just outplaying his opponents. Like, see, he's still beating the Medusa in last hits, which is quite hard to do as a Bristleback. Yeah. So, a bit of non-fighting going on again.
Denied.
Little bit of contestion over here. A bit of a brawl in the jungle. The Invoker bites the dust. Is under attack. So trading an Invoker for a Crystal Maiden there, obviously pretty bad. Medusa picks up a Maelstrom. Pretty good item. Maybe not the best for Medusa.
Thank you.
Oh, it's probably pretty decent for Medusa, but and in this game you really don't want to go for the Lincolns. Now he does pick up his Viscous Nasal Goo here.
Dire's middle tower is under attack. Dire's structures are fortified. Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Go. Nice job picking up those last hits. Nice Sunstrike from the Invoker there, picks up a kill on the on the Storm Spirit, and then the Bristleback bites the dust. So let's just go back real quick and take a look at what happened there, because that is pretty elementary. But yeah, let's just take it 1x. Bristleback goes in, he sees the storm is slow, he wants to get a piece of that action. He gets caught by the Crystal Maiden and the Medusa. He could have probably known there would be a Medusa and a Crystal Maiden over here. Invoker tries for a sniper. The Klinks very close to having it. If he'd had more levels in Bristleback, he would almost certainly have gotten the Klinks there. The Tusk goes in, and yeah. So I think that was probably not worth it. That was you know, a bit of an overcommittal, knowing that there's that many players in the area. You really don't want to dive that hard into the jungle for kills. Bristleback's brilliant for small brawls, but you really don't want to just dive into several players Unless you've gotten really fat top tower early. And this isn't a really fat Bristleback. This is just a pretty decent Bristleback. Now he's a little bit more tempered. He did just die. And there we go. He finishes his power threats. So the thing is, what he needs to finish his Vanguard is just a health booster. That's 1100 gold. It was 950 to finish his power threats. He's so close to having this Vanguard. And the Vanguard is just insane compared to the power threats at this point. I mean, it's 30 attack speed and 8 strength. Versus, you know, an additional 250 health and a really good damage block. Yeah. You can see he's gonna finish it in about 3 minutes time or so, I think. Go. Juggernaut bites the dust. Pretty good gank. Juggernaut being a little bit cocky maybe because the Invoker bit the dust a few times. Someone getting died on bottom, that's the Bloodseeker.
Bottom tower has fallen.
One of the things lower level players do really badly is kind of syncing up when they peak in power level with when they're active. Some heroes it's very obvious on, like say a Tidehunter. Once you get your ultimate, you want to be able to fight, because right when you get your ultimate, it's super powerful. And with Bristleback, it's when you finish your Vanguard if you're going for the Vanguard build, or the Mech if you're going for the Mech build. And you know, once you hit level 6 and you just get your Warpath, you're pretty good. Once you max out your Critless Bay, you're pretty good. So yeah, you should look to fight when, you know, when you get a really good opportunity, or when you peak in power level, it's really good. And that's one of the things, you know, if you, like me, play in a more organized team, one of the things we really talk about is when people have their stuff ready. You hear people say something like, I just finished my outfit, can we fight? So yeah, it's very important. Think about this. Juggernaut comes in. Of course, since Quill Spray is a physical damage ability, it gives Zero Fox about magic immunity. And he was able to do some good damage to the Juggernaut while he was under the spin there. Yeah, so against Nykes or Juggernaut or anyone else who can give magical immunity, Omni Knight, basically. Yeah, Bristleback's really good just because all his damage is physical. And yeah, that also means he's really good combination with armor reducers like Dazzle or Elder Titan. Those are two heroes I really love to play Bristleback alongside, especially the Dazzle. Bristleback Dazzle dual lanes can be really punishing because of the Shallow Grave, and you know, being able to prolong fights with Bristleback stacks is really good. Go, Bristleback goes in. And let's just see how foolish this was from the Storm, because the Storm is quite reliant on his right click damage. If we look at his abilities, they do not do super much damage. It's 260 magical damage here. The Electric Vortex does no damage. He's got a Overload here, which is basically a slow with like 50 extra damage. It's not super much. And then of course the Bolt Lightning does a little bit, but that's more or less just a once-off. So even though the Bristleback is at half health here, he does have a Vanguard. That's 80% chance to block 40 damage. And the melee and ranged values here is whether or not you are melee or ranged. So on a ranged here, it does half as much, basically, in terms of blocking damage. So let's see, the Storm's right click is, let's say, 100. 100 is a nice round number. So let's go through Bristleback's reductions. He's got Bristleback 40% from the back. Storm nearly always catches you in the back if you can manage to turn. So 40% off this means he's down to 60. 60. Let's say, okay, we also have some armor. Let's just check, because I have to play to see the armor values. There you go, 35% physical resistance. Let's just say 30. It takes let's just say a clean third, so 33%. We were down to 60, so we take 33% off that. That's an additional 20. And of course, the Vanguard can block 40. The Vanguard can block 40, and that's just 40, we don't care about the rest, which means that there's basically nothing left of Storm's right clicks. Storm, when the Vanguard procs, hitting the Bristleback from the back, does basically no damage. Let's follow the Bristleback here. There's a few shots coming in on him. Let's see exactly how much damage he takes. Touché! Basically nothing. There we go. Yeah, see, he just went, he just took 15 damage from a right click from a storm. So, you know, this is why it's so difficult to dive a Bristleback. You don't want to do this. When you got the Vanguard, it just stacks up. Everything stacks. And it just becomes so damn difficult. Ooh, one thing I forgot to mention. The free quill sprays you get from Bristleback do not count towards Warpath. These are not Warpath stacks. So, that's one thing that you don't want to do. Yeah. He's lolling, and that is exactly how you do the Bristleback. That is what a Bristleback do. Yeah. Good shit. Good shit. Would have been even more epic if he could finish the Vanguard earlier. You can see the Vanguard here. Before you hit like the 25-minute mark, before, you know, opponents right clicks, before they finish their first big right click item. It's really good. Really, 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 really good. You can also see that his mana pool is actually going to 500 now. And when your mana, your spells cost 30 and 35, that's really good. I would have loved to see him go for a little bit. Ooh, this is really good. So they jump him here. And we see the Juggernaut is trying to do some damage. He's trying to interrupt his spells with the spin. It's really good when you run into opponents who don't know Black King Bar and stuff like that. Don't do shit against Bristleback, because then you can just quill space stack on him. So this Juggernaut is actually in a lot of danger. He's got 3 quill space stacks on. Of course, the quill sprays from the Bristleback stacks as well as the regular quill sprays. So let's just see how this works out for 9muses here. See, actually, we're gonna look at the Juggernaut. See, the Juggernaut, oh, this is starting to hurt a good bit. Oh, 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 he just died. So, they just jump Bristleback with 3 heroes, and he just kills one of them, stays on half-life, and leaves comfortably. This is the power of the Vanguard on the Bristleback. They just cannot fight him right now. Or they can, but it's super hard. And they managed to super easily get a kill on the Klings as well. This is really good. This is exactly how Bristleback should be played if your opponents make mistakes like that. And that is why, you know, why this combination of items is so important on him. And I really like this. This is important. Whenever you find yourself around this area and not really doing anything, check the clock. He's 4 seconds off being able to stack this camp. Of course, I didn't check. So... the Ancients have actually been farmed by someone, so he can't stack it right now, so can't really fault him for that, but normally you should check for that. Another thing Vanguard gives you is 6 HP regeneration, which you see you have a very substantial HP pool. His strength gain is also pretty good, 2.2 per level. His agility is also, like, it exists, so... Yeah, levels on this guy is really good. I've actually been thinking about maybe trying out a Midas build on him. Maybe that would be less than super bad. Or decent, I mean. So, you know. I think he's focusing a little bit too much on his Warpath stacks at this point. You do want an attack speed item other than threats before your attack speed, or before your right clicks get really beastly. So he's using his quill spray to just harass these jungle creeps and just to get his right click up. You can see he gets quite a substantial right click just with a few quill spray stacks. But this, again, is leaving him a bit lower on mana than I would prefer. He is acceptable right now at 200 mana, you can do a lot in a fight. But, you know, a bit more and you can do more. Yep. He's being a little bit more passive than I would prefer right now, a little bit more farm-oriented, and he isn't a hard carry. He didn't play the safe lane farm. He shouldn't be looking to do this, really. He should be looking to giving space to the Bloodseeker. It's basically my take on it. But they are in a bit of trouble, because on the other team we have a Medusa and a Klings and a Juggernaut and actually a Storm. These guys, especially the Medusa and the Klings, have a lot of carry potential. You do not want to let these guys get to the late game. And we have only pushed 1 tower so far. We are in fact behind 2 towers. So they need to make stuff happen right now. And the Bristleback here is just sort of passively pushing in a tower. He isn't brilliant at pushing towers, but I mean, he can do it. You can see he has a nearly, he has like a 150 damage right click, which is pretty good. I believe his next item is going to be a heart, which is really good in a lot of ways, and probably the right choice in this case. There's really two ways to two philosophies to build Bristleback around. This is more like the I'm gonna fight by myself kind of build, which gets the Vanguard and the Heart, which benefits the Bristleback and not really his teammates. The other way is to get the mech and then go into stuff like Vladimir's Offering and what else is there? Well, you could get a pipe and you could get all sorts of other things that your team kind of benefits from. And then kind of use him as an aura platform, a really tanky aura platform. It's kind of what you can do. But this is a fine build. Certainly when you have as much momentum as this guy, I would say that's it's reasonable to go for this. And the reason why you don't get a mech and a vanguard is that they're both kind of timing window sensitive items. And you really probably can't finish both of them in the time where they can. So we are just gonna take this engagement again, because this is pretty good. But let's see. So they're basically doing a gank. There's three guys coming in here, and the Bristleback, he wasn't paying too much attention. Could have gone in a little bit earlier, but it's gonna turn out pretty well anyway. Puts down a disconnected view on them. Because we made the Klinks takes a bit too much damage. He does have a really good right click. You see he has six. He's maxed out his warpath. With maxed warpath, he's 250 damage now.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
And it just take a pretty good fight. Can't really. Okay. So the magic immunity on the Juggernaut does block Viscous Nade to do. That is one thing.
Radiant's middle tower has fallen.
Oh no.
Juggernaut!
Chooses not to pursue there, which is pretty good. So that was just a straight up gank. Worked out well. They had four guys there, a few of their guys TP'd in. They lost the Invoker and the Bloodseeker, which was unfortunate, but it did get the Medusa and the Storm in trade, and I believe the Klinks as well, so that is fantastic. They killed everything they needed to, basically. The Heart is almost finished now, which, you know, this at 26 minutes is really good, but one thing I want to stress is already here 26 minutes. Let's take the Medusa. The Medusa has 135 damage right click, and she does have a proc with magical damage that, you know, goes on top of that. The Juggernaut is also at 130 damage. And in fact, the thing is, even with the additional armor he's gotten from last time, the Vanguard, the 40 damage block from Vanguard, is getting increasingly less effective since it's a lot less now. So even if the Vanguard procs now, they will get damage through. It's starting to look like timing window for this item where it's really, really good is shrinking already. So at 30 minutes, probably it's not going to be super good. So basically, you wouldn't get it at this point, not because it wouldn't be good right away, but it will get bad so fast that, you know, the timing window is not there, it won't be doing much. So now Bristleback's got stupid HP regeneration, and I would actually consider maybe getting a magic regeneration item. Yeah, they're trying to fight a Bristleback with a Heart at 26 minutes. It's gonna be, you know, difficult. Yeah, so that was a good trade, obviously. They traded the two support characters probably for basically most of the other team, which is always great.
Middle tower is under attack.
Yeah, Bristleback's ridiculous sustain at this point.
Radiant's middle tower has
when you hit him from the back still with the Vanguard and the Bristleback, he just doesn't take a lot of damage we saw there from the Medusa. So, good stuff. Good stuff. And he's going. His next item is going to be an assault cuirass. I would not have folded him. Maybe the right thing to do would have been to get the assault cuirass over the Heart first, and then go for the Heart afterwards. It's definitely right that you don't need to stack up more than a Vanguard and a Heart in terms of life points before you get a lot of armor. He has a decent amount of armor, but the way that works is you want to balance. That's the best way to do it. Unless you're against like tons of nuke, then you want just life points, or maybe a pipe or a Hood of Defiance or something like that. But basically, you know, this is the way to do it. AC is a fantastic item on Bristleback. It does give your enemies an armor reduction, which is really good for you. It gives you tons of attack speed, which is also really good for you. And it gives you armor. And stacking up a tank is always a good thing on Bristleback. So it's a fantastic item. Would maybe have loved to see it one item sooner. I think it would give you a very comparable tank. and very, very, very good offensive potential. Though that hasn't really been an issue. Like, it's not like you're lacking it, but having more in that sense is always good. So we're gonna see here Bristleback's Roshan doing capabilities. If he decides to use his nascent do, there we go. Just the fact that he's using it to disrupt the Lincoln Sphere here is gonna be enough. They're gonna give it to the Bristleback. I think probably maybe the Bloodseeker would have been better, or the Invoker. But the Bristleback good too. Like, he is so hard to kill at this point that you can make an argument that probably, you know, if the fight's relatively not completely thrown, then, you know, if there's only like three enemies, they're gonna have a hard time with the Bristleback if he comes all the way, just because it's nearly 3,000 life points in 30 minutes. That's a lot. And, you know, the damage reduction and the armor and how much? It's 56% now. Yeah, so he's keeping up in tank nicely.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Yeah, can't backdoor. Not enough damage. So he's gonna just delay the stuff here. I believe he's gonna get jumped. Yeah, storm. This is really bad. This is one of the worst ways to handle a Bristleback. One thing they are doing that's really annoying is these orchids. There are two orchids in play, and they're both being used extensively on the Bristleback. It's not the worst guy, or the best guy to use it on. I think the Invoker would be a little bit more of an obvious choice in fights, especially if he can do it before he gets his initial combo off. But the Bristleback, you know, if you can silence him, if you can disrupt him, if you can hurricane him up, anything that just takes him out of the fight, makes him incapable of casting spells for some seconds, will just deplete a lot of his stuff, his warpaths, his viscous nature to go, his quill spit stacks especially. It's very important to just, if you can just lower those and make sure the damage doesn't escalate too much. So the fact that they can now silence him for 10 seconds consecutively, then you have the Crystal Maiden stuff, which also lasts for 3 seconds. If you can just keep doing that, and you know, then there's the Stone Gaze. If they can control the Bristleback like that, just keep him silenced in some way, you know, he can't really get his quill space going, and as a consequence, his warpath will also be lowered. And that's a really good way to handle the Bristleback. Yeah. This is not a good way to do it, however. They're still going in on his back, they're still just letting him take all of his abilities without them killing him. Yeah. So that was a lost fight, mainly because they went in. They shouldn't, don't initiate on a Bristleback that has farm. Like, a Bristleback that has this much farm at this point, that's gonna lose the fight.
Radiant's top tower has fallen.
Go round two. This time, the Bristleback gets caught from the front, takes a lot of hits from the Medusa. That means he's taking 40% less. He does have the Aegis, comes back to life, starts going on the Medusa, by the way. Now, the Orchid's preventing him from getting his Warpath stacks off. He goes on the Klinks. Klinks, very soft target, very easy to kill with Quill Spray. Quill Spray does hit, targets are invisible, so there's very few, once the Klinks is low, there's very few ways for him to escape. Same thing goes for a hero like Ricky or Bounty Hunter. Again, an Orchid, he's silenced again, can't build up his Quill Spray stacks. Now, Juggernaut wisely goes in front, still so close to killing the Juggernaut, probably another.
I will not.
He does have 13 armor, but probably another 2 Quill Sprays, or maybe one. Ah, yeah, probably 1 Quill Spray, if we're a little bit generous. Could have been enough there. But yeah, at this point, it's looking like somewhere, you know, somewhere in probably right after the AC, or maybe even before the AC, we should look at picking up a BKB. These effects, these stifling effects, especially the orchids, are becoming too much of a hindrance. If we could have turned, we could just not have been... If those hadn't had happened, he could have kept his stacks up. He could have just gotten so many Quill Spray stacks off that it would be impossible for the enemies. And that's, you know, when you're a fighty Bristleback like this, a Black King Bar can be pretty fantastic. We're going to come to a point here where it's looking like all they need to do for the Dire is just close up the game. And a quick Black King Bar, or even a Black King Bar rebuy, is a great thing to do that. Where you can just get the
Radiant's courier has been killed.
They manage a courier snipe, which is fantastic, obviously. It's not... Oh, it's not fantastic. It's good. It's not fantastic this late in the game. Unless there was something on it. But I can't really check that, so... Bristleback passively farming up now. Just trying to get his sword cuirass. Which, you know, if they weren't fighting, I would really like. But now they're fighting. So, he got stone gazed. Then he comes in. Again, the juggernaut's dead. He's at half-life. There we go. Another orchid. Taking some damage, but it's from the back.
The skies set you aflame.
The ogre bites the claw to the mystic snake. Very nice mystic snake. Go. Turns around again. Keeps his back towards the target. That's one thing. Frostbite quite poor against Bristleback just because of that. Heart just manages to kick in there, keep him alive through the offensive urn usage. So, yeah. Should have probably noticed that his team was fighting down here and headed down here sooner. I know it's very... he needs to finish up this this assault cuirass, but not over a team fight. If he can't, if the team fight is happening, he needs to be there. Though, if he can talk to his team and say, "Can we wait 1 minute? I can finish this assault cuirass. It'll be good." Then that's obviously better. Now he's looking to kind of brawl here alone. That might be a little bit much. It's good to disrupt the farm for your opponent, but I think that might be a little bit too much. So, farming at this point at Bristleback, we see, not a problem at all. And I want to just speed through this part a little bit, because there's not a lot doing, not a lot happening. So, I'm pretty sure he missed a stack timing there again. Really, if you want a bit of quick farm as Bristleback, the Ancients is a great place to go, especially if you get hitted off the stack. They're gonna kill the Crystal Maiden. Juggernaut jumps up four. And Bristleback's just gonna go in. That was a good move. I think he could have maybe continued. They do not have the Crystal Maiden. He did have two stacks up. There's the Assault Cuirass. I think they should definitely turn and fight now. But maybe there's other forts available. Yeah, so. Another issue is there isn't too much farm on the rest of his team. The Bloodseeker's got a decent amount. Though I don't know if another Sanji Yasha, I think that's maybe a good trade there, good trade. Tusk managing to do something, always good. Some Tusk players just seem to stall it so much in pubs. He's a really hard hero to play well. There we go, trying to jump the clinks. Oh, can he get it? Can he get it? Crystal Maiden with a clutch move there. And
here I am.
It's so difficult for them to kill him. So difficult for them to kill the Bristleback. Medusa is also very, very tanky at this point. So we can see he can just die with a little bit of impunity here if you can count on his team. And Orchid comes in. Go, they managed to get the Medusa. Huge kill, huge kill. This is basically saying they can try to take the high ground now. See, these clinks just melt. You know, 150 HP on a Bristleback is still quite a lot. Tusk preemptively calling GG in a game he did very little to win. If a defend is won. This, I would say, here, just focus on the objective. You're getting very little from killing the Crystal Maiden, and you do need to get this Rex.
Radiant structures are for Radiant's middle tower. Radiant's
and they managed to get the Rex. They should go for a second one.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Through these small buildings, you need to get a second set of Rex.
Radiant's top tower has fallen.
And they do get the second set of Rex. This should almost certainly be a BKB.
Has fallen. Dire's top tower is under attack.
He's got 4,000 gold. Definitely be a GKB. I don't remember what he bought here actually. Gonna try to backdoor this.
Radiant's
not
bottom
really
tower is under attack. Radiant's bottom
go.
Tower has fallen.
Or actually, this should be a buyback. He should save for buyback. Now he's going in alone against the Medusa. The Medusa does give a hefty amount of additional damage. The Klinx, especially right now, is hurting quite a lot. The Klinx here. He's got a Monkey King bar and an Orchid. He's on his way to 300 right click with the Searing Arrows. He is at 300, I believe. He's definitely... I think he might even be close to 350. Somehow my math is just getting... Yeah, this is 80. Yeah, he's at he's 350. Or 340. 340 right click. So now, against this Klink, 340 damage. Knocking off 40 of that. Not really that hot. This Vanguard is doing very little against the Klinks now. Medusa already also has a pretty respectable right click at... actually, yeah, because of the spread damage and the Maelstrom, she's actually still hampered quite a lot by the Vanguard. But, you know, the Klinks... Yeah, the Klinks can just melt through you at this point. Still tanky, still very tanky. Don't get that wrong. But, you know, yeah. Invoker complaining that he didn't cast the spell he thought to cast. The Bristleback buys something here, but he's out for 70 seconds. I would be very, very hesitant to not keep up a buyback at this point. Very, very, very hesitant. I think this was not good. Might even cost the Rax. Okay, so buybacks are important, guys. This is a pretty good case where you say, oh, we have two racks, why don't we just... Well, you have to respect how fast your opponents can push. Let's see what's on here. There's a Mystic Staff for our Bristleback. Yeah, he bought a Mystic Staff and now he can't buy back. If he could have bought back for that fight, he could have made a huge difference. It would have been four versus this, and one of them being the Bristleback, who is very farmed. And, you know, the Bloodseeker has buyback, but he wants to waste the 7 seconds. They do have this. They should have just maybe not engaged. Maybe just given up one set of racks, that would have been acceptable. But now they are looking a bit, you know, a bit on the not so good side. Dyer's middle barracks. They lose the middle racks. Bloodseeker. And the Bristleback comes back. Juggernaut comes in. Juggernaut, unfortunately, just doesn't matter super much. The focus on the Bristleback for some reason. The Klinx just dies to the Quill Spray and the Radiant. They get the Storm. Okay, so if the Medusa had stayed there, I think they would have taken that fight. And you know, if the Klinx had just killed the Bloodseeker, that would also have helped. So Bristleback gets a gem and a Shiva's Guard. I think the Shiva's Guard is a huge mistake. I think this should have definitely been a backing bar. Because more armor is, you know... Okay, you get a bit more tanky, you can slow their attacks. But that's not really all that hot. Again, they can blaze through those champs. Now the Bloodseeker gets it. The Bloodseeker, unfortunately, is just not a hot commodity at this point. Though, I will say this. I will say that a lot of the damage at this point is actually coming from the Bloodseeker. He does have a good right click. He does have a Radiance. And you know, with Blood Rage, he should honestly, or maybe not. If the Bristleback has got stacks up, if you can Blood Rage the Bristleback, he will get up to a completely stupid right click. It's 210 damage from a max warpath, and its stack duration is 14. So if you can just Blood Rage him and he has a lot of stacks up, you know, yeah, that's what's that? That's an additional. It's a lot of damage. A lot of damage. Though I don't know if it's the base damage just for this one. And damage increase. Time before applying its buff. Bloodlust can cast enemies sounds to itself. So okay. It's probably just it might just be the base damage. I'm not sure. If it's the damage sum total, then that's really hard. So
oh,
Over here now.
I did you miss what happened? Did you miss what happened? See, that's the start of the fight. So let's just go forward a little bit. Alright, this is how to engage. Bristleback just walks straight up. Everyone just walks straight up. Bloodseeker gets caught in the Medusa ulti. He's basically only done Radiance so far, and he's down. Bristleback taking a lot of damage head on. Bristleback just, he should be running past the point there and hitting someone on the back lines. This kind of scenario. Storm's gonna run after him. He's not gonna be able to kill him because he's still stupidly tanky. They're gonna lose 4 and they're just gonna kill the Medusa. Radiance and they even lost Aegis as well. Attack. So that was a horrible engagement from them.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Pretty much the Bristleback, if you want to do stuff like that, have the Bristleback run in alone, turn his back, force them to go past him if you want to do fullest damage, and then just hit up once the big spell is like, just let the Medusa all just run out and go in behind that. That was a horrible engagement by almost all of his team. In fact, by the Bristleback himself, should have, you know, just run past at this point. Don't let them all hit you in the face. Run in, run at the clinks, get the clinks killed. That's the best plan. Especially if you know had a BKB, you could just BKB up, run into the clinks, just focus him down. Don't mind that you're taking hits to the face from him. You had 3,400 HP with 42 armor. You can take a few hits. You even have a Vanguard. This is an absurdly tanky Bristleback. And you did survive just because you are damn near unkillable. But you know, just, you know, who should be killing? You should be killing the Klinks. Klinks is absolutely the most dangerous guy on their team at this point. The Klinks and the Medusas is the troublemakers, and the Medusa is a lot more tanky. So by all means, just, yeah, this is a lot more of a sensible fight. If you go in through the mid here, the thing is, if you go in through the mid here, you can actually get to the high ground uninterrupted. You're pushing out the lane which you've lost racks on, and you can, you know, not walk into a Medusa ult, all five of you, or four of you, and just get taken out like that. So, a lot more sensible, like this a lot more. However, what's gonna happen shortly is Bristleback's up here, his attention up here, what's going down on here? Oh. Now we're gonna take the Bloodseeker's perspective, because this is gonna be important. Juggernaut runs out, there's Klinks. What's this? Look at that. Klinks tries to focus the Invoker. Doesn't quite get it. But now the Bloodseeker's jumped. Bloodseeker's down. Second biggest damage dealer on their team's down. Bristleback goes in, but he's only got the Tusk. Now the Invoker comes in. But there just isn't enough damage. Bristleback falls. The Klinks is still up. Oh, the Klinks fall back. No one has buyback, just the Tusk. Bristleback didn't farm on his buyback. Critical mistake, pushing high ground without buyback. Should have farmed buyback. I believe he's even pretty close to it. See here. Yeah, he's like 500 close to it. So, you know. Yeah, buyback's insanely important here. And, spoiler alert, this video is already going long, so they are just gonna GG push this. With no buybacks up, you know. We had this happen last time, though the guy, last game, was expecting to get a buyback, but he was just 70 gold off this time. That just wasn't one. Yeah, so good game, well played. Absolutely. No sarcasm there. I think that was a pretty well-played Bristleback. I would have loved to see a Black King bar. I think that's the number one mistake here, is not getting that Black King bar early on. I mean, the Vanguard was delayed, but still it had a lot of impact. He did use his right click, he used his abilities overall very well. He could have Ancient farmed a little bit more, left that easier farm to heroes like the Bloodseeker, was a little bit more of a hard time doing the Ancients before he really gets up to a lot of farm. Yeah, there was a few bad engagements, and you know, not keeping up this buyback was also a huge deal. I also was not a fan of using the quill sprays early on when it was a level 1 so heavily, as it does very very little and you are very reliant on the stacks, which can be against an opponent that is where very very hard to get those stacks. I also feel like the item timings were not respected enough. Those are really big on the Bristleback, so right when you get your Vanguard you want to fight, not right before. Right when you get your Sword Caress, you want to fight. That didn't happen either. Yeah, overall, I think Bristleback was not the weak point this game at all. I think that Tusk on their team had an absolutely abhorrent game. Managed to do very little. But it was very winnable. It was very winnable. If they just kept up their buybacks, it would have been winnable. If they just, you know, engaged a little bit more intelligently those last few fights, didn't get the Bloodseeker picked off alone. In the last fight, if Bristleback had just been there, that would have been huge. If it had been there with a BKB, I am almost certain they could have won that fight really easily. He could have been able to focus down the Klinks super easily with his gem, and that would have been a GG. Again, the skill build, I feel like you could argue for the max Bristleback. You could argue for it. I feel like the second level in Quill Spray, however, is very random. And I feel like they... could have done a, you know, it's not a very well considered skill build. I feel like maxing out Quill Spray first is pretty good. All of his abilities don't scale that dramatically, but Quill Spray just being able to just getting the extra damage per activation is really what you want, and the free Quill Sprays, because it does, you know, it does help you stack up the damage, and it is a lot of damage since you are gonna cast it a lot during fights. So, yeah, I think that's about all I have for this video. If you liked it, you'd like to see more in this vein from me, please consider subscribing or liking this video. And of course, the instructions for sending in your own replays for review will be in the description for this video. My name is Ben Cerebellum, this has been Academy of the Ancients, and I'm out.